So just a little introduction. My name's Tillery Sims. I'm the executive director for the Texas Hemp Growers Association. We are a group of Texas farmers who got together several months ago and decided it might be cheaper to do some due diligence up front and find out if we shouldn't grow it than have spent a lot of money growing it and wish we hadn't. So we've been doing that for several months. We've got all of our board are Texas farmers, and all of our founding members are Texas farmers. And we're a 501c6, we're a nonprofit, so we don't have anything to gain from whatever decision that you make. We just want to be able to provide to you the answers that we have found over the last few months. So we are actively pursuing manufacturers and end-product makers, and we're talking to local farmers and folks that already are working in the pulse business and already do packaging for other kinds of commodities to see if there's a place that we can take our seed and have that marketed this year. So if you have questions regarding where are we going to take it because of infrastructure, I'd be happy to answer those, because right now the answer is there is none for fiber and the seed. So there's some, we do have some hopeful things that we can talk about in the near future, but and I'll be glad to talk to you about those things one-on-one. So you can see me later, I'll be around, or you can talk to Kyle. Raise your hand, Kyle. Kyle's the vice president of our board. He's the only one here that's not on the cotton stripper today. So welcome, and I hope that you will find some answers today. So Dion, you want to come on?
How's everybody doing? Thank you, Tillery. Like she said, my name is Dion Oaks. I'm a co-owner in Wright Oaks LLC. My father-in-law, who's my partner, is Shannon Wright. We're from southwest Colorado, down by the New Mexico border. We started this 6 years ago, and we did about 2,500 acres this year of industrial hemp. We grow for CBD. We grow for grain, and we grow for fiber. So a little bit about our operation. Shannon, he's been in commercial farming for over 30-plus years, doing potatoes, wheat, barley, alfalfa, all kinds of different deals. I've only been in it 8 years, but a little bit about the whole story behind how we got into hemp was I went to my father-in-law, and I said, hey, we should grow hemp. And he looked at me, and he says, you're just a pothead. I said, no. I said, serious. We need to look at this and see what different options this plant's got to offer. And right then, marijuana and everything was coming into Colorado. And so we stepped back and looked at it, and we said, well, let's give it a try. But the main reasons we were looking at this was water savings. We pump out of the aquifer in our region, so water savings is a huge key in our area. Pesticide, herbicide, fungicide, this all has to do with your different locations of where you're growing. Humid environments are totally different than where we're at, where it's real dry, similar to here. So soil health is a huge deal. Putting good stuff back into your soil, remediation, all that kind of stuff is what we're looking at. But hemp itself, on the soil health side, we're looking at nematode control. So potatoes, we got a really bad nematode, corn, that kind of stuff. So we're looking at different areas of where that helps out the soil and can help benefit. No-till, we're starting to do a little bit of that. In our region, we don't do too much of that. So after we said, let's try it, we got a few hundred plants. We started off indoor just to see where this plant is, how it reacts, and what it can do. Then we went to 30 acres. After 30 acres, my father-in-law said, well, we either go big or I'm done. We did it all by hand, planted by hand, weeded by hand, harvested by hand. So we said, well, let's look at mechanical harvesting, mechanical planting, how we can do this and start to go big. So we went 300 acres, 600 acres, 600 acres. And like I said, this last year we did 2,500 acres, all CBD, grain, and fiber. I'll talk about that a little bit more here later on. So just to start off with, we're here talking about two really different types of hemp. You're talking about CBD hemp, which is a big craze right now. And then you're talking about industrial hemp. CBD is the gold rush. That's what everybody's talking about. That's what everybody's looking at. It's a flower. It's the trichomes. And depending on how you grow it, you can get fiber off of it as well. Industrial hemp, you're looking at the grain, the fiber, the flower, possibly a dual or tri-crop off of this crop. So what is CBD? CBD is your trichomes on the outside layer, and this is a picture of, through a microscope of a trichome. It's that dewdropper there of hairs, it looks like, when you're looking at a flower. So you're looking to harvest something very brittle, and the next gentleman coming up, Corbett, he will be talking about that a little bit more of what you're looking at to harvest when you're going through this CBD phase. But you're looking at CBD percentages. Is you're maximizing it per acre. You're looking to get the most CBD percent per acre. There's many different ways of growing for CBD and growing hemp, period. So there's large plant spacing. There's 3 to 5 foot rows, 3 to 5 foot in the row. Then there's mid plant. You got 3 foot rows, 18 to 24 inches in row. And then you got more of a row crop or more of a drilled method of tight spacing. So you got 6 inch to 18 inch rows, 4 to 18 inches in row spacing. So you can do this with traditional equipment, planters, monosims, grain drills, that kind of stuff. A little bit of field prep here. It's depending on your growing operation, you're looking at different techniques for different people. So we do everything from seed. We don't do any clones or starch or anything like that. But we rip, disc, roller pack, land plane, all that kind of stuff. Then if you're looking at starch or clones, you're looking to rip, disc. Then they're looking sometimes to use bed shapers, drip tape, plastic, all these other different different ideas they got. And obviously no-till or strip-till. So here's our monosim planter on the left. And then our grain drill on the right there. The monosim is set up on, one set up on 17s, one set up on 18s, and then our grain drill's on 6-inch rows. Some problems we've seen and some problems that are in the industry right now. The large plant spacing, you're looking at weed problems, in between rows, all that kind of stuff. And then plastic, tearing that out, ripping it out, whatever you got to do, and labor. In our area, labor is not an option. It's very scarce, and trying to get that done on a large scale is pretty hard. Mid spacing, again, weeds and labor. Tight spacing, we can go in there with traditional equipment, and mid spacing as well. You can go through there with traditional equipment and do some cultivation mechanically, but we're looking at doing getting a canopy set. So on our 6-inch rows, on our grain drill, its emergence is quick. We get it up and get that canopy set so we can basically cover everything to choke out the weeds and everything there. On our 17, 18-inch row spacing, we do have to cultivate once, possibly twice, depending on our spacing in row. So a little bit about harvesting here. There's multiple ways, as with planting. There's multiple ways to harvest. There's multiple ways to plant. It just all depends on your operation here. So you got combines, you got whole plant harvesters, you got forage harvesters, you got balers, all that kind of stuff. All of our equipment is Formation Ag, which has also got their booth outside, and he'll be talking here after me. But they got clean cut headers, and they got stripper headers. That's basically their new machine this year. It goes through and strips your flower right off the top of your plants. So by us planting at a thicker plant rate, it creates all the flower or the floral material at the top, so it's a lot easier to harvest rather than going through and taking big trees or bushes. So it all depends on your operation, but those guys have both harvesting techniques to do both. Here's some more pictures here. The top picture's there, and the bottom left picture is the clean cut, and then that bottom right one is the stripper head. Some major factors when getting into this, seed is probably number one. I mean, being in it 6 years, it's still, in some cases, it's a problem of where to buy seed. I mean, this last year, there's a lot of lawsuits going on out there with people on seed quality and feminized seed and this, that, and the other. So it's a huge deal. The pricing is basically the biggest thing is how much are you going to pay a pound? How much are you going to pay a seed? What's going to work for your operation? And everybody just know that getting into this, just start out on a 1 to 5 acre basis as much as you can afford to lose or can afford to plow under, like he says, Delman says. So genetics, major deal there, because genetics from a grain or fiber crop are totally different from a CBD crop out there. So, and there's some mid ones that kind of overlap, but if you're looking at CBD percent or fiber quality or seed yield per acre, there's a lot of different genetics out there to pay attention to and figure out which avenue or which stream you're looking to take here. So location, like I said earlier, is huge. I mean, Kentucky's growing conditions to Colorado to here in Texas, I mean, genetic-wise, totally different. Growing conditions, humidity, all that kind of stuff are huge. So paying attention to those. Labor availability, that comes back to your operation itself. If you're a nursery or something like that, you might have the availability for the labor to do, and you got all the structure and availability of drip tape, this, that, and the other. So all depends on your operation itself. The market is key right now, especially in the last 4 months or so. It's dropped dramatically. There's a lot of different reasons people think that. On the CBD side, I'm talking here, is FDA, their rules, USDA, all that type of stuff was just coming out. But there's so many different factors that got to play with that whole deal. It's dropped about 70-80% since April, since yesterday or the day before when I checked. Risk, like Delman says, and Delman's a part of the Texas Hemp Growers Association here. He says, I mean, don't bite off more than you could chew, or don't risk more than you can plow under. That's huge, because there's a lot of people in this industry that we've seen go in and plant 100, 600, 1,000 acres of this crop here, and basically have to turn it all under and not see any profit. And in our hearts, the farmer's number one, and that's what we need to pay attention to here in this industry, is we got to get infrastructure set up from the back end on these processing plants. And as a grower, it's a little bit different. You can't just take this crop to the elevator and it gets sold or anything like that. You got to look at this as, well, what am I growing for, first off? Which avenues am I going to take for this? And find your buyer first on the back end, is what we always say. And it's helped out a lot of people in the industry so far. So buyers, now that I'm speaking of buyers, finding them first, again, be careful with your buyers. Who's out there? What are they looking to do? And what kind of contracts? Doctor, he'll talk about that later. What kind of contracts are they looking to do? What's the fine print? What are these guys looking to? Let's talk about industrial hemp here. We got grain, and grain is the seed that's produced inside the flower material after it's been pollinated. So a little bit about hemp. It's got the male and female side, which a doctor will talk about later as well. But with this, we grow male, and in our operation here, we grow male and female plants together in the same field for CBD. So in our operation, the CBD percent that we're looking for is anywhere from 6 to 8, so we're not going super high grade, but that also cuts down our risk a little bit, because you're looking at your CBD, high CBD genetics are really playing a really tight curve in your 0.3% THC that you're allowed legally. So having that higher CBD percent, well, higher THC comes along with that. So keep that in mind. If we're shooting at mid-grade, 6 to 8% CBD, then we can collect seed, we can collect flower, and we can collect fiber off of this. So on the grain side, it's a lot higher planting rate. Your seed cost is a lot lower than your CBD genetics. And more traditional agricultural farming there. You got your grain drill like you saw earlier. You can go in there, plant it 20, 25 pounds the acre, 30 pounds the acre, and get a really good stand to create that canopy. It's less risky like I talked about, but on the fiber side and the herd, I'll talk about it a little bit, and the other guys will talk about it a lot more in depth, but it's kind of the secondary part of this whole deal, and the market development is not there at this point. There's a lot of people looking into it. There's a lot of avenues. There's a lot of leads going on, but market development is not to the point, and the specs haven't been set for fiber and herd and all these other deals. So something very important there, but you can get some major tonnage off of an industrial crop with this. So you got a lot of fiber and bales. We swath everything. We take off the tops for industrial. If we're going for strictly grain, we take off the tops with a combine, come back, swath and bale the stalks. So it's regular traditional equipment that's out there. A little bit about the fiber here. Like I said, Corbett, and we'll go into this a lot more detail, he's a really good expert on this. But you got the outside layer of the stalk, and then you got, which is your long fibers, the fibrous layer of that plant. And then in the inside, you got your herd, or the inside part of that is your herd. So that'll go for many different deals, hempcrete, insulation, all kinds of different operations there. The hempcrete itself has got a really, really, really good neat profile there of R40 insulation value. Once it's mixed, the herd itself, without being mixed with lime and water, it will catch on fire. But once you mix it with lime and water, now you got a fire-resistant product that is going on for your building materials. They got the LCM material, lost circulation material, and the oil field. They're really starting to look at this as another viable powder to go down their holes and all that kind of stuff. Biochar, plastics, bedding. Canada's got a huge market on coming in here and over there of bedding and all that kind of stuff. So this. There's a lot more to this plant than just the CBD that's going on right now. They got the fiber, they got the seed. There's the seed itself has got a lot of amazing uses on your omega 3, 6, 9, your protein side, the feed side. After you take that hemp seed oil out of that seed or expel it from it, the feed value for that, the protein and fiber value on all that. The only bad part right now, and that's what the Hemp Feed Coalition is working on very hard, is getting that. It's the USDA and AFCO and all that have not accepted or said, no, we cannot feed this product to our animals. And originally when Hemp Feed Coalition went in there and said, well, let's look at hemp as a feed, they went to AFCO and said, well, we're looking at using the flower material, the foliage of this plant. Well, that contains the CBD and the THC part. So they said, well, we don't want anything to do with CBD and THC. They said, well, let's look at the seed. The seed itself in a raw form does not have any CBD or THC. Once it's grown, it produces it in the plant itself. So AFCO said, yep, let's give it a go. And we're in the first stages right now of getting the trials going for AFCO to figure out. Their main worry is that even though starting with a seed that has nobody's found any THC or CBD in the seed, but they're worried about it carrying over into the consumer market. So if you fed this to chickens, they're worried about it getting into eggs, cattle, all that kind of stuff. They're worried about it being in the meat. So we got to go through this. Hopefully 1 to 3 year study that's going on to get this figured out so we can get this as a viable feed, which can open up a lot of different avenues for the seed itself and the byproducts from it. Banking, Doctor will talk about that later a little bit as well and touch base, but 6 years ago when we got in this, banking was super hard. As of last night, the Bankers Association put out a deal and to all their FDIC banks and said, hey, treat this as a regular traditional agricultural crop. So hopefully this will help. It's a step forward in the industry, but we need to really pay attention to what Texas here locally is going to do and be in contact with your banks. And one thing we learned was be straight up right away, what you're doing, what you're growing, what you're looking to do as a farmer. Crop insurance, at the FDA level, there's been a lot going on lately of what's going to happen with crop insurance. They did announce that it will be available for this next season, but they want to learn more. They want to learn more what's going on and how they can create a program to help cover hemp. Right now, there's a lot of stipulations regarding this of you had to have been growing the crop for, I think, 3 to 5 years or something like that. So there's a lot of work still to be done on the crop insurance banking. Hopefully the banking just took place last night. Hopefully that takes care of a lot of everything. Some speed bumps that hopefully we can help you guys with here is labor and weeds were our number one. And this whole industry in the last 6 years has adapted and grown dramatically on implements, on technologies, on all this type of thing. So it's still going, and it's really good to see. But harvesting and drying, building the relationship with Formation Ag was key to our success so far of getting harvesting and drying and all this other. After you grow the crop, there's a lot more to it that you got to go down the line, and Corbett will see that. But that's Formation Ag's been huge with us. There's a lot of snakes out there. Snakes are number one. I can't in Kentucky. I made the news there of saying this because the snakes are huge in this industry, and I can't stress that enough. I want each and every one of you to be aware of what's going on out there, who you're dealing with, because there's a lot of people thinking this is a gold rush. They want to get in. They're promising high numbers per acre and all this. So please, everybody, as a farmer, and number one in our hearts, of please vet everybody and look at all the people that are looking to do business. Some takeaways. Work backwards from where your end market is, where you're looking to grow, because like I said earlier, your CBD varieties, your grain varieties, your fiber varieties, all different types of varieties there. So you got to figure out, okay, well, is there processors in my area? What are they looking to buy? What's their specs? What type of variety then do I need to go out there and get this to the next step? Build relationships with a lot of trusted people in the industry. It's new here in Kentucky. I mean, not Kentucky, Texas. Sorry about that. In Texas. So there's a lot of people looking to come in here. In other states, they've been around and been doing this a while. So look at other states. Build the industry to last. That's one thing I stress a lot is, I mean, we've been in it 6 years, but really this is still basically the start of this whole industry. It's still very new, and there's a lot of things still to develop. I mean, CBD is number one that's going on right now, but hey, there's a lot of different things on the fiber, on the seed, and all these other operations we can take advantage of to help your local economic development in your states and in your towns and all that kind of stuff. So education, especially being so new here in Texas, education is huge. Talking with some people here today, was they didn't know much about hemp and what it was and how it was totally different from marijuana and all this types of things and uses that it could go for. So education is huge, especially at this early stage and even throughout. Even there in Colorado, even though we've been around it, education is still huge of what's going on with hemp. What can hemp do? How can it play a bigger role in your cities and towns and everything like that? I stressed this earlier a couple times, was the farmer. The farmer one's number one in our heart, and we need to look at this as a new direction for the farmer to look and go in his day-to-day operations on his farm. I mean, it's a whole nother crop. It's a lot of avenues we can take, and as an entrepreneur, you can look at this and really take it by the reins and look at processing, look at all these other deals that you're looking to do. But number one in our hearts is the farmer's got to be taken care of. That's why I stress on the snakes and scammers and all that is we've seen a lot in the last 6 years go on throughout many states. So thank you all. This is some pictures of our crops, how we grow. Any questions we'll take care of later, but I'll ask Corbett now to come up and get his presentation together. Thank you all.
Corbett Hefner, Vice President of Development to Business Development for Formation Ag. I'm going to talk mostly about harvesting today and some techniques and equipment that we've done, showing you some different harvesting in different fields, different cultural practices, and just kind of try to open your eyes on different ways to farm this crop. Like Dion said, this is a chance for you to be an entrepreneur, create demand for a product, and really help your bottom line. So you can be as creative as you want or as little as you want. But the opportunities here really are endless. The advocates will tell you there's 25,000 uses for it and there's ways to make money in this thing, whether it's small scale, large scale, whatever you have. Why didn't an index there? You gonna do it again to me? Did this yesterday, it didn't want to advance. Okay, so back to harvesting. First thing to do with harvesting is start planning right now for it. 2020 will sneak up on you. You cannot believe the number of people who called us the day before harvest and say, I've got 1,000 acres. What do I do with it? That's kind of a problem when you're that late in the game. So start planning now. Like Dion said before, plan your sale of your crop beforehand. I'm going to talk a little bit more. I'm going to start with grain just because everybody's CBD crazy, and I'm going to show you some of those techniques. But, you know, here's four general categories: grain, oil. I call it oil instead of CBD oil just because that's what it is. Fiber, there's smokable bud. And then, you know, you've got a place to take your crop now. What does that customer of yours want the crop to look like? You know, does he want it ground? Does he want it beat up? Does he want no stems in it? Can there be no seed? And if you're doing CBD flour, or if the seed you're making seed for grain, you know, do they want it? How clean? What size particles of what do they want to look at if you're doing oil? And when do they want to have it? Say you grow your crop, you're done harvesting, you get everything done. The guy says, I can't take it until June. Well, where are you going to store it? Hemp doesn't store all that well, and it's quite bulky because it's light. So you have to have a lot of room for it. So a couple things to think about. And then what are you going to do with the crop after you harvest it? In our area in Colorado and probably here in West Texas, I would assume that you might be able to field dry it. But a question was that is what is your risk tolerance? What happens? We had a guy cut 120 acres down that was on plastic this year. We got 2 inches of snow on it. So now he's got a mold problem. So is that a viable thing for you, or are you risk tolerant or adverse that you can handle it? Can you air dry this in a facility? If you're going to hang dry, which is the conventional way of drying hemp or marijuana in that industry, when they hang a plant, if you're going to do that on 4-foot centers over cables, it takes roughly 44,000 cubic feet, not square feet, cubic feet, to hang dry an acre. If you're going to put it on the ground and put culverts or air flow somewhere underneath it, it takes about 18,000 cubic feet. You also have almost exactly 2 hours to get some sort of air underneath this crop before it will start to get hot and start to mildew and do all kinds of bad stuff to you. Mechanical type of drying, there's belt dryers, rotary dryers, there's some large turbine dryers. Each one of those has a different capacity. So once you've already sold your crop and you know what it is, you know, how big of a dryer would you need if you're going to need to dry? And this is mostly for the coastal regions and down south. But, you know, what's your budget? How many pounds an hour do you need to do? A 2,000 pound an hour dryer, you know, if you do tobacco barns, might be $40,000, $45,000 a machine. And, you know, you can only get maybe a quarter of an acre in one. If you want to dry 100,000 pounds or more, those machines can be $1.5 million, $2 million. I've seen one that was $5 million. So what's your budget for that? Again, if I didn't have my crop sold, I wouldn't go drop $5 million on a dryer. That's a lot of money to me. Since I'm going to talk about grain, when you harvest grain, you're going to do it when it's quite a bit greener than what you're used to, because hemp is very shatter prone. So you're going to harvest when about 10% of your crop is ready. Same thing with your doing flour. You've got to get it dried soon. So you've got to have some sort of a drying bin. I'll show you some pictures of that. And then just budgets for drying. You know, what do those things cost you? And then the storage, you know, how can you store it effectively? If you're doing a fiber crop, once you've taken the grain off the top, if you're dual-purpose cropping this thing, you've got to ret the crop. We make decorticating equipment that breaks that fiber and herd down, and it's got to be retted, which is a controlled rotting process, which breaks down the lignins that bind the fiber to the herd. Without that, it's quite a bit difficult, more difficult to decorticate because it's sticky. It binds together really well. Then once it's dry, just kind of like hay, you can use your normal hay equipment. Round bales are a preference because it doesn't break up the long fibers. Long fibers are preference in textiles, cordage, ropes, all kinds of things like that. Square bales still work as well. I haven't seen small, you know, 80-pound bales work all that well in hemp because it's the nastiest fiber you're going to put your hands on. If there's a bearing there, it'll tear it out. And then if you're doing oil or even the grain, start considering your food safety program. Somebody's going to ingest this product. So you got to test for your pesticides, heavy metals, herbicides, all that stuff. Need to make sure you're producing a safe crop. And I throw this slide in here. In Colorado, almost every acre by us got pollinated in one fashion. So what happens if you're a seed oil producer and you're going to sell your CBD oil to somebody and there's seeds in it, and your extraction guy goes, oh boy, I don't want that because that's got hemp seed oil. Hemp seed oil and CBD oil are not the same product. So we've built some machinery like this. This is a big air separator that pulls the seed out here. The flower comes up in here, and we catch it in this machine and put it in super sacks. Looks like a simple little machine, but that's quite a bit of technology in there to separate the two, and they work pretty slick. So I'm going to talk about the grain. In case you haven't seen it, this is hemp grain, and this is dehulled hemp hearts. So that's what those things look like. This is that's a typical wheat Shelburne stripper running on dry land grain. This wasn't a very good stand, so he was probably getting 500 to 700 pounds per acre. That crop should have been in the 15 to 2,000 pounds an acre. But here, we make this piece of machinery. This is my grasshopper cart, where we're drawing the chaff out of the back of this combine. And he takes that because it's been removed from the grain. The CBD concentration is a little bit higher because CBD is measured as a percent by weight. So we're collecting that. This guy owns his own extraction company, and he takes it straight there and he extracts it. So it's a second revenue source off of that. His primary goal is the grain. This guy's a pulse crop farmer. He exports everything he does to India. So he's got a nice market there. But the CBD oil is a second source of revenue. Makes it pretty attractive to him. Somebody asked me outside a minute ago, can you dry land it? 12,000 acres right there. Dry land, northeast Montana. So this is that grasshopper. He said it's a vacuum cart. We never impact the chaff when we're collecting it. The entire top of this machine is a filtration and air dispersal media. It's totally self-contained, so most combines don't have the horsepower to run something like this, and they don't have auxiliary hydraulics. So we build that machine. It's controlled from the cab, and he's running a 32-foot shell burn at 5.5 miles an hour. Every time he dumps the grain tank, which is an hour and some change, he dumps this cart into a truck, and off he goes. Handles the terrain, because I don't know if you've ever been to that Montana dryland area. It's really hilly, so it's pretty country. This is another machine made by Bish Harvesting. This is their super crop head that they did for sunflowers and milo, but it does work quite well in hemp. This isn't probably the best genetic for grain. You would prefer to have the top third of the plant have all the colas in the grain. The more fiber you feed into that combine, the more chances you have for mechanical damage from fiber wrapping. And once fiber wraps on something, it gets hot and then it likes to catch on fire. You will want to have a lot of fire extinguishers around. Hemp is quite flammable. If you take a pile of fiber, hemp fiber that's been broken down and throw a match, it looks like it's been soaked in gas. It's only fire retardant until they mix it with lime. Okay, these are Meridian drying bins in Canada. When this guy harvests, he fills this one up about a third or half, blows air through it for a day to get it dry. Then he moves it to the next one the next day because it takes a couple of days to get it down to normal storage. So that's kind of that process because you do have to dry that moisture out of it. I'm going to go back to CBD harvesting. This is a bud in one of the Rite Oaks farms before we harvested it. And you know, I put these slides up here so you can see these little hairs and trichomes are exactly what you're going for. That's what drives the design of our equipment, is how do we keep these from being damaged? I think I got a slide in here that shows you what the fiber or the CBD flower looks like post-combining. All those trichomes disappear. So you take a crop that's ex-jollage genetics that you just spent a bunch of money on in seed, and when you harvest it, you can lose between 50 and 90% of your crop. These are the trichomes under magnification. It's literally a little sack on top of the trichome. That's what you're harvesting here. So if you rupture that trichome, if you break that sack open, the chemistry takes over. It starts to oxidize immediately. Now, if you're trying to grow full spectrum, broad spectrum oil, you've lost that opportunity because the terpenes flash off. Things start to degrade immediately. this is a picture of post-harvest of our clean strip machine. These are the buds in the semi-trailer. A little hard to see, but if you want to see it in person, come up, and I've got it on my iPad. But this is a post-harvested, transported, and dried bud, and all those little hairs are still there. They're all still intact. So we've got test data showing that we have not degraded the oil content in this plant. So that's very important. Get test data, validate, like Dion said. Question this stuff, vet it, validate it. We work closely with these guys when we develop these machines to get this test data so we can say, look, here's what it is. Here is our hypothesis, and here's what our actual test data is, so it works. this is that machine harvesting the buds into a truck. Our preference is to run the grasshopper behind this machine and collect the buds, but in this instance, we didn't get the chance to put them on there, so that's the buds, and it's leaving somewhere between 70 and 90% of the fiber in the field. Why is that interesting? You've got a couple of reasons. One, it dries much, much faster without the stem because the stem retains most of the moisture. And the second one, it gives you an opportunity as an oil farmer to get the fiber revenue off of this plant. So if you're growing at tight space, it forces the colas and the buds vertically, and you might have a 6, 7, 8 foot tall crop, and then you can go back in and get 2 or 3 tons an acre of hemp grain on there. Of course, genetics depending. This is that same machine, our clean strip machine. This is the last harvested pass. If you look closely in there, it's kind of a little shaky, but there's no buds left on that foliage right there. This is the next pass. You can see some of the buds sticking up. And you know, genetics are not homogenized by any means yet. We're still several generations away from having, you know, when you go out to a cornfield or a wheat field and everything's the same height. Hemp isn't like that. You'll see phenotype expressions, different colors, purple, yellows, green, and then you'll see different heights of the same thing. It's not quite there yet, but that's that machine. This is after a frost. People think you can't harvest CBD oil after it freezes or snows on it. That video I showed you, the grasshopper in Montana, been snowed on 2 or 3 times already. Does not seem to degrade the oil content. You'll have to do your own validation and study on that, but the test data that they've got from these two regions are not showing it. So that's just something I thought I'd point out. This is Oregon. same machine. These are about 4 foot tall plants. Doesn't really look like it. That's our clean strip machine. If you look in the background, you'll see the stalks that are left over because we're removing those buds out there in Oregon. That in theory was supposed to be 8 foot tall trees. Planted a little late, they got a pile of rain, it got cold. Now we got 4 foot tall trees. So plan for plan B always. It's gonna happen to you when you're doing hemp. This is a pair of our clean cut harvesters. It's a draper style machine. Looks like a normal draper, but it's not. This is a 68 inch reel. This is 60 inches in depth. And then this boom is geared towards when you cut that plant, get it out of the field so you can get it dried and contained, unless you're in an environment that allows you to field dry. So for the most part, we take them and get them into a facility to dry, okay? This is in Pennsylvania. This guy's a tomato harvester or farmer, so he's using his tomato wagons. Same thing, he was a little late planting, but if you notice in here, he's got a cover crop in to help his weed suppression. That's a really low stature clover. Beautiful little plant. We're actually cutting some of the clover, and it's dropping out right in here between the two belts. So pretty much the only thing going into that tank is hemp. So really neat little field, just a gorgeous place to take video. The guy said he didn't even color correct this video. It was just so pretty that day when they were doing it. But just showing you, here's a rotation crop. He's a tomato guy. So even they're trying to do it. And you see, this is dry land. You see the next strip over there? So somebody asked me if I could do fiber or something dry land. It's possible if your conditions are right and your environment's right. this is Kentucky, whole plant harvesting, tobacco infrastructure, 40-inch plant, row spacing, 40-inch plant spacing. This is post, what was the hurricane last year, Dorian, that came through. This crop was lodged. We're actually cutting counter to some of the rows because you couldn't see them. The wind pushed them down, and you can't see them. So these are cotton wagons he's taking them away in. He's got 35 of those. He harvests for 4 hours and takes them away, and it takes them the rest of the day to put those up and process them. And he's got a huge crew of people unloading those things. I mentioned turbine drying. This is that 150-pound machine. This actually uses the same auxiliary engines that are in the back of jets to create a little bit of heat. You don't want to pour a bunch of heat into CBD flour. The general rule of thumb is 110 degrees Fahrenheit. And then you start to decarboxylate and degrade the oil content. So this is using about 85 degrees in temperature. It's kind of a fluidized bed inside of here. And then some augers to give it agitation so they can get the plants drier. Very large machine. Custom harvester owns this thing because he's going all the way from Oregon through California, Arizona. It's a portable machine. That's on two low-boy semi-trailers. what happens if you plant a little tighter and you let it go longer? This is in Lithuania. We have a machine cutting in Lithuania. This crop was roughly 15 feet high. If you look here, there's a fan leaf, but what's missing? There's no buds on that. So why would they harvest that? Because there's no oil-producing material. They're running 10 feet off the ground cutting this crop because that's where the buds formed. So point being the tight plant spacings, this is the most adaptable plant you'll ever see. If you put it in a tight spacing, it grows vertical. If you leave it by itself in the field, it'll look like a Christmas tree. Same seed. We've got volunteer seeds that came out of organic fields 2 years ago that were 14 feet high. They couldn't even water it because the sprinkler wasn't tall enough. And they put potatoes in the next year, and it looked like little five-foot Christmas trees. Amazing to me. This is post-combine. Remember that bud picture I showed you that you could see the hairs? Again, if you want to see this up close, all those hairs are gone. It's been destroyed because they combined it. This crop went into the machine at 8% CBD content, came out at 1.8, 77% loss just because of the way they harvested it. Just pointing it out, not saying you can't do it. People do it because that's what they have and that's all they can afford to do. But be prepared for loss. And it's a philosophical question. Why would you go spend money on high-dollar genetics if you're going to harvest this way and degrade your crop? You know, you're better finding a mid-content genetic and farming it differently. Getting back to that pollination thing, if you've combined or if you've got whole flower, whatever you've done, and it got pollinated, we've got some techniques that we can break that bud down and get the seed loose, and then we can collect it in this machine, and then that's the flower. This is an extractor on the backside of that wall. This guy takes all this flower. He set up as a remediation company where people have taken their pollinated crops. They take it to him. He's breaking it down, and extracting the oil out of it and salvaging it, because most extractors really don't want that seed oil in there. And we do some grain cleaning equipment. We can clean the hemp in both fashions, either whether we're using traditional air separators to clean the grain to pull out non-viable seed and chaff and other debris, or these scalpers we're just showing you, just kind of this is wheat running, but that kind of technique still works in the hemp. So we've got some of that equipment too if you don't have things. So again, use what you have, but these are really reasonable. And we like these machines because nothing ever really touches a crop, because the seed coat's kind of thin on the hemp. This is a screen cleaner. And here, even after you thresh some of your crop and you rake it down, get it to extraction, you get these little pieces of stalk, little half-inch, one-inch pieces of stalk. There's no value to running that through an extractor. It just hurts their throughput. So we've developed some techniques to take that out of there. So here, these are the larger pieces of debris. This is a stalk. This is the flower we're collecting. There's some on that chunk of wood there that's ready to go to extraction. Unless it's got seeds, then we'll take the seeds out of it. So there's some techniques for the removal of that. Just showing you again options in case something happens. So that's that little machine. And this is what it looks like. So this is the flower that's going to go to extraction. These are some of the mid-sized pieces that came out. And there might be some flower in there, so you'd run that back through and clean it once more. And then these are the big pieces of stem that really can make a mess. And that was pretty much it. This is one of Wright Oaks' farms in Colorado up by the mountains. And that's one of those 6-inch row spacing drill crops. So if you got any questions, we'll have them after Dr. Calvin speaks. And we're happy to talk to you. Our booth is just right out here, 1903. And again, we're happy to talk to you about that stuff. There's a lot of different ways to farm this thing.
All right, so that's the picture for my background. I think it's waking up here a little bit. So questions for you folks. I would like to know my audience here just a little bit. I know we have one fellow from southeastern New Mexico. How many of you folks are from outside the Texas High Plains? Anybody? Okay. Where from? Okay, Clovis, eastern New Mexico. Anybody else? All right, next question. How many of you consider yourselves currently a farmer or a producer? Show of hands. Okay, so about half the group. How many of you are considering the possibility of growing some hemp in 2020? Show of hands. Okay, there was about 6 or 7 of you here. Okay, so what I want to do here is I need some... I have the screen, I have what I want on my screen here, but it's not showing up on the computer. That's my background picture on my screensaver. So do I need to do something different here? Restart the computer? Okay, I can do that. Here we go. All right. So what I like to do here is, is in my role with Texas A&M AgriLife, one of the disadvantages we have as far as hemp is concerned is we have 0 people in our agencies, either AgriLife Research or Extension or main campus, that have worked with hemp before. So that's a challenge for us in terms of how we are able to come to you with information that's relevant. Let's see if we can keep working on this here and come up with our picture there. We had trouble with this yesterday. So what I want to do here is we'll talk about some things. And my role here is, well, let's go back to the Texas legislature. We were very fortunate that the Farm Bill was passed and signed when it was, because in Texas, that gave us the opportunity to have our legislature address the possibility of hemp legislation that would be allow industrial hemp to become legal in Texas. That occurred. Why does New Mexico or Oklahoma or Colorado have industrial hemp? Well, they started their programming under the auspices of the 2014 Farm Bill. And so those were pilot programs, and now they will have to come under the new issued federal interim guidelines that we have coming for 2020 and beyond. So where we are in the legislature, Texas A&M AgriLife, we were not for or against the hemp legislation. We, in a few cases, we answered some questions in terms of what helping understand the plant, some cropping, what some economic issues might be. And then where we're at now is USDA issued their interim rules at the end of October, and so we're now in the midst of a 60-day public comment period. Once those are finalized, then Texas Department of Ag will likely have their final proposed rules submitted to USDA. I think there has to be a public comment period at Texas Department of Ag as well. So TDA has said one of our concerns is that when we had a Wichita Falls hemp program November 5th, one of the spokespeople for TDA said they did not believe they would be able to receive or start reviewing license applications until mid-March. So I think the dilemma there is we could be beyond the optimum planting from mid-March approval. I think we could be beyond the optimum planting window for maybe, I'm speculating, but perhaps the south one-third of Texas. And we'll just have to see where we come out with that. So we'll talk about that just a little bit more here. Any other ideas here, fellas? This worked fine yesterday. Just drag what over? Okay, come here and show me what you're talking about. I may learn something new about my 7-year-old laptop computer here. I hope you're right. So anyway, the things that I want to share with you is we'll kind of go through some of the maybe in a chronological process, the thinking that you would go through. This is not going to be a discussion about how you grow hemp, not in much detail. We don't have that information for Texas. There will be a Texas A&M Ag program, I think, will be very active when it comes to hemp research in New Mexico State. They have one hemp faculty position they're advertising for. Oklahoma State is the land-grant university in Oklahoma. They have chosen not to be involved with hemp. I think maybe at some point there may be some pressure that they will have to do that, but that's their decision for right now. Other things that we think about as we go forward is, you know, my points today are to help you think about, to evaluate, maybe to project some things in terms of what we want to see going forward. We'll talk a little bit about the hemp plant, and there's a couple of key things we're going to talk. Some of the biggest issues I see right now for you as a prospective hemp grower, if you're sitting on the fence wondering, is this something I should be interested in, costs and so forth, all we need to do now. Well, now, okay, if you can trick that into hitting the icon down there so I can have full screen. I see it spinning. Hey, you did it. All right, and he's got, let's see if this works. That works, and that works. Okay, thank you very much. have thoughts sometimes of getting somewhere to a grower meeting and my laptop fails or I forget my jump drive and I have to do it all from memory. So, but anyway, just some things here as, let me use this. As we talk about this, is we already covered that here. We're not here to promote hemp. That's not my job. My job is to help you get more information so you can make that decision. And that decision could be that very readily, this is not for me. So the question is, you know, is hemp farming for you? What will your objectives be if you're to do this? Here's one way that I look at this as I explain to growers. I work with sunflowers, have for about 18 years. I grew up in the sunflower state, Kansas, but I didn't learn about them until I came to West Texas. But I have said to many producers across not just the High Plains, as far south as the lower Rio Grande Valley, that sunflower in Texas is a crop that half the farmers that I know probably should never grow. Why? Well, there's a few hints there on the screen. There's a couple of things in sunflower that you absolutely have to take care of at the right time. That doesn't sound like the kind of farmer dad that I had growing up in eastern Kansas. And the thing is if you mess up sunflower head moth control, you get a mess out here on the right that's rhizopus head rot, and then people are going to gripe and worse for the next 15 years about that sunflower crop they grew, and they swear they'll never do it again. So with all the things that are involved in hemp production, if I ask myself, well, what about Texas farmers that I know and growing hemp? Do you think it would be that more than half of the farmers I know probably shouldn't bother with hemp, or less than half? You can imagine that it's probably more. I'm not going to put a percentage on that because I don't know yet. One background, something that's different about hemp. We have male plants and we have female plants. Other crops that we grow in Texas that could be like that spinach, I understand, is a male and female plant. Cassava, not grown in Texas. Male plants, female plants. Something that would be a little bit different is a corn plant has a male, the tassel on the top where the pollen is generated. The female is the ear where the pollen transfers to. So something that you hear about, you will hear some people talk about hemp production. In fact, probably the strong majority assume that you need basically a near zero tolerance policy to any male plants in the field for CBD production. For fiber, it doesn't matter. And or even if you have pollen in the air from fields, maybe even several miles away, that's not a good thing. That it, in theory, should curtail the amount of additional CBD that you can produce. Now, I actually have questions about how, is that really true? And in my mind, after discussion this morning, I thought there's some simple tests I could put up to just see if we really do curtail CBD production. The standard thinking is that if you have males in the field, you have pollen available, you get seed development, you're going to reduce your CBD levels, and so you don't get the high quality material for CBD extraction. High quality meaning basically nothing more than high percentage of CBD. So one way that this is done is feminized seed. There's a treatment of seed, and then you produce a female plant. And that seed is, if it's done correctly, is very reliable. You might get one male plant out of 5,000. You can have some plants will what they call hermaphrodite that are actually both. And if you're wanting a clean field with no female plants, you need to remove them. The dilemma, folks, that unlike anything you've probably ever done before, unless you've grown watermelon, is feminized seed can be $1 per seed. And how about planting 1,500 of those per acre? Ever had any cotton or corn seed costs run $1,500 an acre? No, of course not. So there's, you know, maybe that's one of the first flags that tells you that there's something very different about how this crop is produced. So I won't talk about hemp products. You've heard about CBD, the substance you get from the floral structures. There's, you know, here's an example of some of the words I've had to learn how to pronounce and spell. But there's other materials like CBG and CBN that may become important in time, may have even higher value than CBD, but there's no varieties that produce very much of those right now. Grain and fibers has been discussed, the bast, the exterior material, the herd. There's a lot of CBD products retail. How many of you folks have used a CBD product? Show of hands. That's more than the people that said they would grow. And there's the medical world needs a lot more research on CBD products because there's only a very few documented cases that they're used for. One of my contentions about what you paid for your CBD product, unless you got a free sample, is I remember as a kid growing up in Kansas, we were proud of the fact that if you bought a loaf of bread, how much, what percentage of that loaf of bread's retail price went to the farmer. Well, that percentage is low. Wheat Producers Board in Texas said it's about 7% right now. The pair of jeans I have on probably weigh about 3 pounds, $1.80 worth of cotton. I buy them on sale online at Lee, pay $30. That's about 6 or 7% of a pair of jeans actually goes to the cotton farmer. If you're dairy, you hope that maybe the dairyman gets 40%, at least 33%. So what I've done is some calculating. And in this particular example here, we've got a container here that's got 900 milligrams of CBD. This seller actually provided analysis of the product. I thought, that's cool. They're standing behind that product. It's actually got in it what they say it does. But on that product, 0.8% of the $72, about 65 cents, actually went to the grower who produced the CBD. That's just an aside to what we're really here to talk about, but it shows you some examples of how to look at this. You saw a picture of the seed earlier. This is actually somewhat like a sunflower seed in that you have a hull, and then you have a meat inside, or what people call the hemp hearts. Yesterday from Texas Hemp Growers Association booth, for the first time in my life, I did something new. I ate hemp hearts. No opinion on what they tasted like or anything, but I figured they're probably good for me. So the grain, there is a very small grain market. The seed market might be bigger than the grain market. North Dakota has had hemp production for 4 years. They have one elevator that receives hemp for grain, none in Colorado. So same picture here. There's your herd, your exterior fibers there wrapped around that stalk. This stalk really is somewhat like a cotton stalk, but then you've got the bast fibers here. That's kind of the core, the woody-like material in the inside. And so that material is very versatile. Tensile strength, temperature, durability, ability to maintain strength under harsh environmental conditions. That's one reason why it's valuable for so many products. All right, so very briefly, the two main things that you hear about for hemp, CBD, and THC. More letters, more words to learn how to pronounce and spell. Tetrahydrocannabinol is the narcotic component of marijuana. The 0.3% criteria has been set by the federal government. That is, if it's above 0.3%, it will be treated as marijuana. If it's 0.3% or lower, it's hemp. 0.3% or even higher than that is, as far as something that somebody could get high from, not even close. And we laugh about the examples of people sneaking into somebody's hemp field thinking they're getting away with something, and they realize that that's not the case. But anyway, this material here does, CBD can, under certain conditions, slowly convert to THC. I don't think that's a major concern. But this is where the regulatory process occurs here, and there's going to be a lot of discussion in terms of how we measure THC in order to determine if a crop is going to be legal. Some first things to remember here. There is an incredible amount of hype around the cannabinoids, the CBD component of hemp. I did an interview with an Austin American Statesman reporter, Bob Seckler. Nice writing. He said, "You cannot harvest hype." I thought it was pretty good. He was interested in some other examples there. A lot of misinformation. Some of it, I have to say, is fraudulent in what some people are being told. I've heard several examples of that already here in the Texas High Plains. A seed that's very high, expensive, maybe $1 per seed. It's supposed to be feminized, and it wasn't. And so what do you do if that's what you ended up with? And, you know, do you have any recourse with the folks? If it's a reputable seed company, I hope it was, you might. But if it was somebody else, they may be gone. Those profits, that revenue that you hear from per acre, those numbers, to be downright honest with you, those numbers really don't exist anymore. It's still possible to gross a few tens of thousands of dollars per acre, but the kind of prices that supported this crop initially are not there anymore. There are financial risks. If you increase hemp acreage from 2018 to 2019, by two-thirds, what's going to happen to price? This is on the CBD side. What happens to price when you increase corn acreage or cotton acreage by two-thirds? That doesn't happen. You might increase it 10% one year. So that's one of the examples why there's risk here, because we have how many states growing hemp now legally? It's in the range of about 40. And about 5 years ago, it was just a very few. How many of you have heard some comparison about emus and hemp? How many of you know what emus is all about? Late 1980s, early 1990s, there was a kind of a craze that developed in Texas and other states, emus. A pair of emu breeding birds maybe selling for $20,000 a piece. Emu was going to be the new, I guess, white meat. Emu oil was going to be the new oil. So the hype that you hear about CBD and so forth in emus is probably comparable. But my assertion is there's a key difference here. Hemp, CBD, other cannabinoids, the hemp grain, the hemp fiber, each have inherent value in a way that emu meat and emu oil never achieved. And so that's the distinction that I make here. That example comes up a lot. Here's another important consideration. Since we're in the high plains and we're concerned about water use and long-term Ogallala water availability, and you might be from other areas, you know, if you're in the Artesia area, you're concerned about availability of water off the Pecos River and so forth. Early on, one of my colleagues made these statements that hemp uses maybe about one half the water of cotton. Very quickly, a number of us said, we do not think that's true. I still have seen this information online from some other groups across Texas. I think that if you have an acre and you think about that acre's productive capacity for cotton, whether it's 1.5 bales with very limited irrigation or 3.5 bales with good irrigation in your management, I think that's about the level of water you would anticipate putting on an industrial hemp crop. Half the water of cotton? I don't think so. If you are growing for CBD, the cannabinoids, where you have such a high investment in that crop, I do not foresee any dry land production in the Texas High Plains. In fact, I think the combination of rainfall during your cropping season, maybe up to 4 months, and your at-plant soil moisture needs to be at least 15 inches if you're going to go without irrigation. So that's for other areas. I will say, as an aside, though, I think there is a possibility, maybe a good one, that hemp fiber in West Texas may be a viable opportunity on dry land. I hope that AgriLife can get some research initiated as soon as 2020 to help address that question. One Colorado farmer I know says that you cannot starve a crop into profitability. Why would you want to do that when you're spending high amounts of cash to grow a crop? Well, you're looking for places to cut expenses back because you've already put a god-awful amount of money into this crop. But he says you can't cut corners or you're going to shoot yourself in the foot. His estimate there was hemp can be grown on about 40% less water than corn. Another comparable example, that was his perspective. So let's look at this plant a little bit. Here's the small Christmas trees, 4 feet. This plant grown on 5 feet row spacing, about 5 feet in the row as well. So you've got lots of buds all over this plant, all the way down to ground level and so forth. What we saw from the formation presentation is some of that harvest with the stripper header was looking at maybe the same variety, but planted close together. And you have a tall plant, and you take off the top. Now, you couldn't do that with expensive dollar a seed feminized seed. That would have to be what we call straight run seed. And we'll come back to that here in a moment. But anyway, in this case here, this is a hand harvest project where they're going to dry. Here's an up-close picture of those trichomes that Corbett talked about. That's the material that produces the sticky substances that have the CBD and other cannabinoids. You rub your fingers over it, they glisten in the sunlight. They're shiny. These trichomes are very important. And I would say, you know, why do farmers that we know in Artesia area in West Texas and even up in South Central Colorado at high elevation Maybe not so much there. Why do farmers here in the High Plains area bale their alfalfa at night? Why? They got to keep the leaf. They got to wait for the moisture at night to come up. So in this dry, semi-arid environment where humidities might be in the range of 15% or even lower sometimes, they moistens up at night and they can keep that leaf on the plant. That's for the hay. That alfalfa leaf is the most important part of that plant. You lose that, you lose a lot of value on your alfalfa hay. So this is a comparable example with keeping those trichomes on there. Here's a field near Portales. Farmer had some struggles here, first year production. First thing was his combination of seed wasn't quite what it was supposed to be, and he was planting in June, which we think was probably maybe made his situation worse. He got a very poor stand. This is a hand-harvested field. He had some other issues like bindweed and so forth, but you know, in spite of this, it's still worth going after and producing, but it looks like over most of his fields, he got about 20 to 40% of the plants that he intended to have. And one thing I saw in there, we talked about seed purity and seed quality. We have lists from some states that are approved varieties. Those are not the same as certified varieties. I hope that in a couple years, we will have certified varieties for hemp, but it's going to take some work to ensure that we start with some clean genetics that we can get to a certified variety. But it doesn't show up so well in the picture, but in that yellow box, when I was looking at that field, supposed to be one variety, I saw five different distinct plant types in this field, in that small area. Supposed to be the same variety. You are not going to get anything probably close to what you're used to in purity for a wheat variety or a cotton variety or a corn hybrid short term for hemp. This was the first hemp picture I showed, the field there, 5 foot centers. No plastic over the rows. Furrow irrigated. I believe most of this was going to be hand harvested. They're going to have the capacity to get that dried. Just down the road, this is in southeast Colorado, Rocky Ford, La Junta. Another field, very different. These plants were a little bit taller than I was. This was irrigated with surface drip lines. I'm not sure how they were going to handle this. There's floral, at least on the end here, there's floral structures all the way to the bottom of that plant, and you have quite a few of them down into the canopy there. So I'm not sure how they're going to handle that, but it's a different look. Here's another field in New Mexico. The thing about this situation is what saved this farmer was he had a buyer arrangement that was different. He was not growing the crop himself. He had received a flat fee plus a percentage of gross revenue. The contractor, who should be able, knowing the industry better, should have been able to get better quality, higher quality seed, but that was not the case. Then again, they compounded that with the fact that they couldn't get planted until June. And in that particular situation, of all the acres that were planted, they were only able to salvage about 1/8 of them that actually went to harvest. That's about the best that he had. So folks, this is a lot different than other things that you perhaps have done. Something else I want to mention here. Some of Corbett's pictures with the harvest equipment was all oriented towards large mechanized agriculture. We recognize that across Texas, there will be many people that are not interested in 5 acres or 50 acres, let alone 500 acres. They may be interested in half an acre. They've got a little piece of land they want to grow. It'll be all hand labor. They'll probably pay for all the costs themselves. It wouldn't be a shared agreement, but there's a significant portion of that. I saw a map yesterday of where hemp licenses were granted in Kansas. And wow, Kansas City area, southwest of Kansas City towards Lawrence, maybe towards Topeka, and right around Wichita. There were a lot of pinpoints on that map. My guess is those all represented very small acreages, a couple acres. And so this is another thing. I think it comes back to the terms of what are your goals for hemp production? Are you interested in a larger acreage, at least down the road, big ag type? Or are you looking at smaller hand, more hand-driven operation where you're looking for a higher percentage of material? And that may depend on what kind of buyer you have who wants you to work with. But one of the ways that some of this can be done, is we've seen some interest in small greenhouses or hoop houses. This is a greenhouse setting. I actually think I may need to get a better explanation on this picture because some of these plants here actually look like trees. I don't think that's what you would find. So this might have been a clone production system, is using clones for part of your planting. But my extension horticulture colleague at Lubbock works with hoop houses. And these are examples. They're 30 feet by 100. And he, with a hoop house, he can extend his growing season for strawberries and some other higher value crops by at least 6 weeks at the beginning and the end of the season. So he may be able to add maybe in the range of 3 months to a growing season. So I could see that somebody could easily produce maybe two crops in a year in a hoop house if they're somewhere here in the Texas High Plains. All right, here's a headline. This came out of an online publication just recently. When you think about acreage went up, prices came down, what about demand? Some of you that tried CBD products, maybe in just a curiosity, kind of a, I'm just curious, let's give it a try. And a few of you maybe says, I feel like it's helping my joint pain or my arthritis, or is there some other reasons, back pain, something chronic? But this is a concern. Again, I just want you to be aware of the fact that when all the hype that was out there was predicated mostly on the massive revenue that people were able to generate, $40,000, $50,000, $60,000 per acre off of 1 acre. But the prices that made that possible have, I wouldn't say evaporated, but they've dissipated to the extent that we're back down to earth. We don't know about ongoing demand in the U.S. Dion, I even wonder about the possibility of CBD exports. No other country in the world is producing the cannabinoids. So maybe that's a possibility. There's, I'm sure, lots of roadblocks to that from other countries, mainly tied back to concerns about marijuana. But two things here that I want to mention to you in the same vein. One is there are many different ways to grow hemp. You saw a couple examples earlier. If you sat in on the program this morning, then there were some other growers talking about how they grow hemp. And so a key thing here is anything that we grow, we do not shoot for maximum yield. Or there's very rare instances where that might be possible, because maximum yield is not maximum economic return. I'm sorry, economic profitability. You try to grow 5.5 bale cotton somewhere in Lubbock County, you found out it cost way too much to do it. Your profits were better if you backed it off to that 3 bale range. So different ways of growing hemp, seed type. You could start with clones, or maybe clones generated from tissue culture. Clones could be cuttings off of a mother plant. Clones, by the way, do not develop a taproot. So that could be a concern in some areas where you need to rely on deeper soil moisture. You could have feminized seed. You could use the feminized seed and plant it directly, or you could do transplants from that seed. That is, grow seed in a greenhouse, then transplant, or you can go with straight run seed where you're going to have 50% males and 50% females in the field. CBD content in your material. If you've got a buyer, if you follow Dion's suggestion about identifying that tail end of that system is where you're going to sell that to, they've got criteria that they're looking for, and so you may need to grow to meet that criteria. And they might want high percentage CBD. So that would change how you approach your production practices. If you've got a processor that's content, maybe they recognize there's some economy of scale in terms of how they can process larger volume material, even if the CBD percentage is lower, maybe that's that particular processor's better way to their own profitability. Planting pattern, you saw examples of thin, moderate, and dense planting patterns. I don't have any opinion about that right now. The one reservation I would have about seeing somebody only plant, have 1,000 or 1,500 plants per acre is there's a lot of sunlight hitting the ground that becomes completely unproductive. And that's not normally how we try to farm our crops here in Texas or anywhere else. Irrigation. There's different ways to irrigate hemp. There's some that advocate that you have to do it with drip irrigation on drip lines with plastic sheeting. I look at West Texas and I thought, well, We've got a bunch of farmers here that have center pivot systems. They are going to figure out how to grow hemp with a center pivot system. And one of the advantages you might have is if you have shallow planting depth, which what I've been told by some industry could be maybe no more than a half inch. Dion, what's your planting depth? Half to three quarters of an inch. Put that on a sandy clay loam to start to get into sandier soils. You have a worry about something drying out before it gets germinated. So sprinkler pivot irrigation, if you can get around the field and got the capacity, can help you keep moist until that seed is germinated and established. Then you could go to drag socks if you're planted in a circle. Those are very water use efficient. So there's different ways to approach that. Harvest. You saw some of the upper end, larger acreage approaches. It could be as simple as cutting it off with a machete by hand and hanging it up in a drying shed. I think harvest, I'll mention it. I could add here drying also. Maybe I'll do that when I update my slides. When I did this program, a mini workshop in the Texas Gulf Coast, South Texas region, it sunk into me like, oh my goodness. You know what humidity levels are at Waco and Corpus Christi, in Austin and Houston and those places, it's hard to get things dry. And so there I could see that if they can't get reliable field drying before it rains again, then they're going to have the capacity to get their material drawn into some kind of drying facility. And so that may put a cap on the number of acres that they could grow. All right, major issues. Poor seed quality. That is certainly a concern there. If you are concerned about this, I believe that we should understand that the varieties of hemp that are grown for cannabinoids, like CBD, those varieties remain today still fairly closely related to marijuana. They are going to be more likely to have an issue with THC. The varieties that I've been told that are used for grain or for fiber are further removed from marijuana. Those varieties are probably tougher, can grow maybe in tougher environments. A lot of your marijuana type lines, marijuana background lines, were grown up in a cool northern California forest or in a greenhouse, and they didn't have to fight out here with a little bit of wind or something like that. It's in temperature. Fiber and grain varieties we think are far less likely to have issues with THC. There's a lack of openness among the hemp industry. That can be a concern. Dion talked about that. You continue to hear inflated numbers about the profits you can make. A colleague of mine shared recently that there was a small town northwest of Lubbock where some folks were talking to growers there and making statements about what kind of money they could make on hemp for fiber per acre. Completely preposterous. No one in the U.S. or Canada ever made that kind of revenue. I'm not going to say the number. The number they were trying to tell people they were interested, nobody in North America ever made that kind of revenue on an acre that was grown for fiber. And those are things that we've just got to sort out when they come about. Colorado farmer says his costs are about $13,000 an acre. USDA report, and I don't like these numbers that well, that was their rules guideline. They said average farmers spend about $19,000 per acre. I think that represents a lot of very small hand-oriented operations. These costs can come down because there's economy of scale starting to come out, but there's past prices there. But I will say this, my ag economist colleague would say the prices and economics for hemp in 2019 are going to be out the window when it comes to 2020. It's changing that fast. All right, let's see, next slide here. Okay. Soils suitable for hemp cropping. Don't have this issue in the Texas High Plains. We don't have soils here where we're waterlogged. It's very rare. You might have some low spots near a playa basin that could be a possibility. Be a very different issue in East Texas. Hemp does not like wet feet. You need well-drained soil. pHs, the literature from other universities suggests pH 6 to 7 is ideal. All the hemp that I've seen grown in Colorado is in the range of at low 7s to at least 8. I see no limitations in Colorado on hemp that's grown up to pH 8. I don't think pH is a concern here. There's no soil testing to speak of. If you submitted a soil sample to Texas A&M and say, I'm going to grow hemp, Tony won't know what to do yet with what recommendations to make. We don't have any of that kind of data in Texas. So the other thing is some folks advertise that you can get a test for your hemp to see if your soil is fit for hemp. Maybe charge several hundred dollars for that. You don't need that test. You've got a standard soil testing lab here in Texas, Oklahoma, Colorado, Kansas. These other soil tests will suffice. Pesticides and hemp. IR4 program is looking at fast-tracking two different chemicals. One is a weak herbicide for broadleaves, vermoxynil, more commonly known as Bectrel, not an effective herbicide unless it's tank mixed with others. And then there's a major fungicide there that I believe is headline, the azoxystrobin. Let's talk about insects here. There are currently no labeled insecticides for hemp. Now, if you get over in the organic world, there are some materials that you can use that tend to be repellent or maybe suppressive, but they're not really what you're used to in terms of a fungicide, an insecticide, or herbicide. The thing here with insects that we have concerns about, we're hearing from other states that fall armyworm, some of your corn earworm, cotton bollworm complex in other states is starting to show activity on hemp. We've had questions about grasshoppers, mixed information there. If grasshoppers start to feed on the floral structures, I think that's a potentially a very big problem. If they stay on the leaves, maybe not so much of an issue. I don't know about beneficial insects. We wonder about stink bugs on coastal Texas might be an issue. And until we grow the crop for a few years, we really won't know where we're at. So have any of you got weeds? This is a farmer in Colorado. Because of a bunch of rain that he got, he could not make additional cultivations when weeds were small before his hemp plants got very big. And so he ends up with a lot of pigweed. And the harvesting system that he has is he was harvesting the whole plant with the combine. So my estimation is that 20 to 25% of the biomass that was going into that combine was pigweed. So that pulls your CBD down. And what I would say about weeds is, you know, in Texas, I work a little bit with some other minor crops. Sesame, guar would be two examples. For sesame and guar, both we have a few, three or four, maybe five herbicides that are labeled for those crops. And for those crops, we say, do not put guar or sesame on weedy ground. So if you have zero herbicides labeled for a crop, do not put hemp on your weedy ground times two or three or four. You're looking at possibility of a couple hundred dollars an acre for weed control with hand hose if that happens. Pigweed, Palmer amaranth, careless weed, whatever name you dislike for that plant, that's the most common one issue I hear. Bindweed can be a problem in some areas. Planting early in Texas to get ahead of the weeds, I don't think that's going to be a possibility here. Plant diseases. I have a colleague at College Station, plant pathologist Tom Isakete. He's already written a primer on what he anticipates could be significant disease possibilities for hemp in Texas. Happily, for any of you here in the Texas High Plains, his main concern should not be yours, and that is cotton root rot. Tom anticipates, that cotton root rot is probably going to be something we may find that hemp is at least moderately susceptible to, if not highly susceptible. We have cotton root rot over much of Texas. Some areas more than others, cotton root rot is the number one reason why we do not have alfalfa across most of Central and South Texas. In the High Plains, I've been told that verticillium wilt is a possible issue. I need to see some verification that that's actually the case. What Tom will do once A&M AgriLife is licensed to work with hemp is probably he will start some greenhouse tests, pot studies, and start looking at the response of a few hemp varieties to some of these different diseases. Powdery mildew on the Texas coast, I think could be a significant issue, especially if it gets into the floral structures. I think right now for myself, with all the crops that I work with, this is the area of hemp that I have the most uncertainty about right now. What is the appropriate planting window for hemp in Texas? I've heard in Colorado, growers who plant currently in May saying we need to move forward to April. Another grower in Colorado says, well, I actually plant some of mine in July. What about soil temperatures? These are all uncertainties. If I had a dream situation, it would be at Lubbock and several other places across Texas, is to start planting hemp on 3-week intervals for maybe a couple of months and just see where we end up. But I don't know about this. The one thing that I have here that is a concern is if licenses from TDA are not available to at least mid-March, again, like I mentioned earlier, I'm concerned that a third of Texas, the south third of Texas, could be beyond what may be, what we may find is their optimum planting window. And so my concern for folks down there, I'll be east of Austin next Tuesday for a couple of programs and into Houston. What do I say to those folks? You know, I say I could foresee a situation where it says, by God, I said, I'm going to plant hemp. I'm going to do it. I think it's probably late. It may be too late, but somebody gave me $50,000 to help me with my hemp, and they're adamant that I get this done. And so we'll have some folks that maybe plant too late, and we think that could set themselves up to some issues there. Right now in the Lubbock area, you know, we hear mixed feelings. Some suggesting that we should consider some hemp planting in March. Others saying even though you could grow it at corn temperatures like, corn temperatures like this one here is that hemp temperatures for germination are kind of like corn, 50 degrees minimum. Doesn't mean that you should plant it that early. Some of the seed folks believe that a light freeze on hemp is something to be avoided if you can. And so that would say in Lubbock, maybe not plant until at least mid-April. All right, here's a common concern. I've read about this in several different venues and online and other folks. A lack of understanding among a lot of growers in U.S., new growers, first-time growers, understanding the issues involved and the effort required to get their crop harvested and dried down. There was a group in western Colorado, Montrose Delta, this past year. First-time grower, a bunch of investors from Austin, I believe, was where they were from, 1,000 acres. And they got hit with an early freeze on October 9th, and they had no plans in place as to how they were going to harvest their crop, let alone get it dried. It's just beyond belief that that could happen when they've spent that much money getting that crop started. Here in Amarillo, my colleague Tiffany Dow-Lashmet is at the A&M AgriLife Center here in Amarillo. She's an ag law specialist. She's an attorney. She is writing and commenting on legal issues surrounding hemp, and I think she will continue to do that. Some of her emphasis is going to be on the contracts that you have with growers. All right, contracts with growers. Another colleague of mine has read a number of these example of contracts. He's already reviewed a couple of potential contracts that have been offered to folks here in Texas. And what he notices is it seems like there's a lot of outs in those contracts that favor the processor buyer that would be disadvantageous to you as a prospective grower. Our advice, and I don't know whether other states are saying this, but our advice for the time being in Texas is, because my interest is in you as prospective growers, is if you have somebody you're talking to about a contract, there's a lot of things that need to be defined. That contract is not going to be like growing a field of sunflowers for Red River or Black-Eyed Pea Contractor at Muleshoe. It's going to have pages of information. You need to have a lawyer, your lawyer, look through that contract and give you advice. And let him raise the yellow and red flags if they're necessary in that grower contract. All right, so another thing, in the same way that there's many ways that you can grow hemp, the grower arrangements that you have with the contractor buyer also can be widely varied. They could range on one hand from you simply receiving a flat payment, maybe $1,000 an acre, maybe negotiate so split costs like irrigation or something like that, but you basically grow the crop for the contractor. The other end is it's all yours. All the expenses are yours. All the risk is yours. This is the person that needs crop insurance, whole farm revenue protection available in 2020, but you have to have 5 years of farm income. Maybe, I don't know that that's 5 years consecutive, the most recent 5 years. And the crop insurance, whole farm revenue protection, will not cover a loss due to a crop that is has to be destroyed because of high THC. So that's something to be aware of. But anyway, so if you're the farmer, I showed you the picture from New Mexico where they had trouble with the stand. That farmer didn't need crop insurance. It was not his risk. He got a payment, and that payment was better than what he gets off the other crops that he grows. And so that was his comfortable level of approaching it. So when the stuff didn't germinate, he wasn't about to commit suicide over $3 or $4 million worth of feminized seed. It was the contractor's issue and expense. The one thing about a grower getting a flat payment to manage the crop is, well, that means I don't get any chance to make $20,000 or $30,000 an acre here. That's right, but think about the risk. You'll have to see what you're comfortable with. You ask lots of questions. I can't emphasize that much. You got to verify the claims. You've got to ask for, you know, do people have a track record? How many people can come to you right now in Texas and say, well, you know, we're processing CBD, blah blah blah. There's, you know, how many CBD processing facilities there are in Texas right now? Of course, zero. Will there be one or two or three or four able to receive a 2020 crop in Texas? There's people planning on it. Let's see if it gets done. I need to see dirt moving. I need to see sewer lines being installed and electrical lines hooked up and walls and a roof. Those are things we're going to have to look for as we get into next spring. All right, let's skip that. Pressure to plant. You made up your mind you're going to do this, and there's something comes up that says maybe you shouldn't do it. Maybe 2021 is better. You're going to face pressure that you just want to plant really bad. That's dangerous. Again, it comes back to the risk that you have. And so there's lots of things to involve that. And by the way, everything that you see here on the screen will be online at our website. I'll give that to you here. Actually, this is it. Next to the last slide. This is where the Texas A&M AgriLife is posting our resources for hemp in Texas. Do if you decide to grow. There's a lot of discussion going on with producers in other states, especially if you're in the Texas High Plains. We're very interested in what producers in Colorado and New Mexico are learning, Western Kansas. But that's our state information there. If you're online looking for information, one way to thin out some of the uncertainty of what you might be reading is to focus on the information from other universities or states Department of Agriculture. So where are we going to go here in Texas? I have some optimism about hemp. I think it's going to prove to be a reasonable rotation crop. Most of the producers that I talk to in the Texas High Plains, established growers, seem to view maybe 1 or 2 years of possibility on the CBD production, but I think their interest long term is fiber. No hype related to hemp fiber. We need hemp fiber processing here. There certainly is discussion going on. I'm encouraged what I hear about different individuals, different groups that are looking at fiber production in West Texas. Myself, I want to get my hands on this hemp plant. I want to be able to plant and grow so I can take measurements and read and start the process of learning how this plant grows so that I can help producers in Texas in their management of this crop. I leave you with this thought, just not to discourage you, but just to help you understand again, you can't overemphasize the amount of cost, the revenue, the planning. It's one thing to grow hemp crop. It is quite another to think about how to identify good seed. How do I identify a reliable buyer contractor? How do I get this crop harvested and dried? Those are all important at a level that's beyond what you're accustomed to in the past. And we don't know yet a whole lot about what the Texas Department of Ag rules are going to be. And so that in itself is another area of certainty. But we had a grower in Wichita Falls, November 5th, said, well, if you're strapped for cash, how are you going to afford seed and all the cost and hoe hands and whatever it takes? And my thought was, I was sitting in the back getting my next presentation ready. And I thought, if you're thinking I'm strapped for cash, then my thought was, one, two, three, four. There were four doors into that room over there, Tillery, and I thought, he needs to pick one of them and leave, because that is not a good fit for that situation. We've got time here for questions and answers. Any of the folks that have visited here would be happy to visit with you. And myself here, we can visit here. We may need to, we got about 20 minutes here, but we'll formally adjourn at 4 o'clock. And if some of you want to linger and ask additional questions, that would be great.